thing that needs mentioning here is the patient's airway compromise associated with mandibular fractures. Fractures of bilateral subcondyle and bilateral parasymphysis may create an unstable situation for the tongue because the fracture segments tends to fall behind. So here there is a need for immediate consideration or intervention. Mandibulus, the largest and strongest of the facial bones, which is basically a tubular long bone which is bent into a blunt V shape. It has an outer dense cortical bone and loose cancellous bone within. The cortical bone is thicker anteriorly and at the lower border, whereas it weakens as it moves posteriorly. It becomes thinner. So it means that the mandible is stronger in the anterior region, in the midline, and weakens as it moves posteriorly. Even though the mandible is basically V-shaped, it has been modified to four functional processes, namely the angle, the coronoid process, the condylar process, and the alveolar process. Now let us discuss each part of the mandible in detail. The superior border is the alveolar process, which contains the dentition. The inferior border is made up of thick cortical bone. The mandible has two surfaces, the outer lateral surface and an inner medial surface. The body of mandible joins the ramus at angle. The two bodies on either side fuse at the center, called the symphysis. At the symphysis, there is a thickened cortical area which is known as mental protuberance. Mental foramen is present on either side of the mandible, either side on the lateral aspect of the mandible, and it is present between the roots of the first and second premolars. An oblique ridge runs from just inferior to the mental foramen posteriorly and superiorly to the ascending ramus. This is about the lateral aspect of mandible. Now, coming to the inner surface. The inner cortical surface at the midline shows two pairs of bony prominences. Here you have two pairs of small bony prominence, which is termed the genial tubercles. The geniohyoid muscle originates from the inferior genial tubercle, and the genioglossus muscle originates from the superior genial tubercle. Then, running horizontally backward is an oblique ridge, which is called the myelohyoid line or myelohyoid ridge, to which myelohyoid muscle is attached. Below the myelohyoid line is the submandibular fossa, which lodges the submandibular gland, and above is the sublingual fossa, which lodges sublingual gland. The quadrilateral structure that you see here is the ramus of the mandible. The lateral surface is rough and thick at the angle region by the insertion of masseter muscle, as you can see in this diagram. On the medial surface is the mandibular foramen that continues downward and forward into the mandibular canal and transmits inferior alveolar nerve and vessels. Lingula is a medial bony projection at the opening of the mandibular foramen, to which spinomandibular ligament is attached. Myelohyoid line is an extension from this lingula. Myelohyoid line extends from the tip of lingula downward and forward on the medial aspect of mandible. Below the myelohyoid line, in the ramal area, you can see a rough surface here. This is due to the insertion of medial pterygoid. So you have attachment of medial pterygoid on the medial aspect of ramus, the inferior part and masseter on the lateral aspect of the ramus. This is a notch. You can see a notch over here. This is found at the superior edge of the ramus. It is called the mandibular notch. It is bounded by two processes: coronoid process anteriorly and condylar process posteriorly. The fan-shaped temporalis muscle attaches to the tip of the coronoid here. The temporalis attaches to the tip of the coronoid process, and the attachment of lateral pterygoid muscle is at the anterior portion of the neck of the condyle. So this is the condylar head. This stalk is called the neck of the condyle, and on the anterior aspect of the neck of the condyle you have a small depression called the pterygoid fovea, to which lateral pterygoid muscle attaches. A detailed description of condylar head anatomy as well as its fracture management shall be discussed separately in subsequent lectures. Now, moving on to one of the most complicated regions of mandible in terms of both anatomy and management, that is the angle. After condyle, angle region is the commonest site of mandibular fracture. What could be the reasons one could think of? The anatomy of the angle itself will explain it. Angle is a junction, and the junction or a joint is always weaker when compared to the adjoining parts. Angle is a junction formed by the adjoining ramus and body. Every bone has a specific pattern of calcification lines. In case of mandible, the direction of calcification suddenly changes from horizontal at the body to vertical at the ramus. And the transition happens at the angle region. Thus, angle has a comparatively thinner cross section than most of the other areas of mandible. In addition, presence of wisdom tooth, which could be an erupted or an unerupted one, presence of inferior alveolar nerve canal, and constant opposing muscle actions of the elevators and depressors make angle a difficult area in fracture management. Mandible is one bone whose muscle attachments have a continuous functioning, be it mastication, speech, facial expressions, swallowing, yawning. So you cannot expect the fracture to remain still once it has occurred. Displacement is a very common feature of a fracture, and it is important to understand the action of each muscle on a fracture. The first group of muscles is formed by the suprahyoid muscles, which exerts a force in the posterior, medial and inferior direction. So if there is a fracture segment in the anterior mandible, it is displaced inward, backward and downward direction, as you can see in this diagram. The next important muscle group is the pterygomastoid sling. You know that the ramus has attachments to masseter muscle on the external surface and medial pterygoid on the internal surface. Therefore, at the most posterior inferior aspect of the ramus, there is a tendon or a sling which is formed by both the masseter and the medial pterygoid, which is called the pterygomastoid sling. So in case of an angle fracture, it is this muscle action that causes the posterior fragment to move in a superior, medial and anterior direction. So if there is a fracture at the angle region like this, imagine there is a fracture like this. In this case, the segment containing the condyle is called the posterior segment, and the segment containing the dentition is the anterior segment. Therefore, the pterygomastoid sling will tend to displace or move the fracture in a superior, medial and anterior direction. This is the superior, upward, medial means inward and forward direction. The next muscle of concern is the temporalis. You know that the temporalis has an elevating and retroding action. temporalis is attached to the tip of the coronoid process. Therefore, in a fracture, it tends to displace the segment in a posterior and superior direction, that is backward and upward. Similarly, lateral pterygoid also has two sets of actions, each produced by the two separate components of lateral pterygoid. It has an internal and an external component. The internal component is responsible for the anteromedial displacement of the condylar head in a superior direction. Both the components move the segment in anterior and medial direction, but the internal component moves the condylar head in a superior direction and the external component in an inferior direction. The direction of the fracture at the angle can vary due to various peculiarities of the angle discussed earlier. Here you need to understand the terms favorable and unfavorable in context of mandibular fractures. If the direction or angulation of a fracture is such that it can resist the displacement of the posterior segment due to muscle actions, then the condition of the fracture is favorable. That means if this is the fracture and if the posterior segment can resist its upward pull by the pterygomasseteric sling, then the condition of the fracture is favorable. In the previous section, we have seen the action of different muscles on a fracture. So keeping the same in mind, we will now have a look at the horizontal and vertical favorability of mandibular angle fractures. This diagram shows the horizontal viewing of a fracture and this diagram shows the vertical viewing. Here the terms horizontal or vertical are defined from the viewpoint of the observer. Hence it is a traditional but not very practical terms. Thus a horizontal favorable fracture extends from the upper border downward and forward. This is the direction of a horizontally favorable fracture. This pattern of fracture is termed favorable because of the locking effect at the fracture site. The locking effect is produced by the anterior segment. So when the pterygomasseteric sling tries to pull the posterior segment upward, it is locked at this region or at the fracture site by the anterior segment. Hence it is termed favorable fracture. Whereas in a horizontally unfavorable fracture, the fracture line extends downward and backward. Unlike in a favorable condition, here the fracture line extends downward and backward, and thus here the locking effect is absent. The pterygomasseteric sling can freely pull the posterior segment superiorly. So this is how a horizontally favorable and unfavorable fracture look like. Likewise, a vertically favorable fracture runs from the buccal plate posteriorly and medially. Here also you can appreciate the locking effect at the fracture site. Whereas in a vertically unfavorable fracture, the fracture runs from the buccal plate anteriorly and medially. It moves forward and inward. There is no locking effect present here, and this enables unopposed action of the pterygomasseteric sling, thus displacing the posterior segment. One more thing that needs mentioning here is the patient's airway compromise associated with mandibular fractures. Fractures of bilateral subcondyle and bilateral parasymphysis may create an unstable situation for the tongue because the fracture segments tends to fall behind. So here there is a need for immediate consideration or intervention. To sum up, it's been told that mandible is the strongest of the facial bones, but still mandibular fractures occur twice as often as midface fractures. The reasons being the unique osteology of mandible and the various muscle attachments that causes fracture displacement. Another reason is the presence of dentition. The socket is a weak zone, especially if the teeth are impacted or unerected. So does it make children more susceptible to mandibular fractures? Actually not, because a child's bone is more flexible and resilient. Therefore, the incidence of a complete fracture is lesser in children when compared to adults. So that's all about the basics of mandibular fractures. We shall be discussing the management in detail in the next lecture. Thank you.